I just wanted to share with everybody the couple of the conservation projects that we've been doing, really why I got into it in the first place. I mean, this is a picture of a beautiful reef, something we all want to see. But what about stuff like this? This was from the Similans. The stories that they have disappeared now. What about this? Bleaching in Australia, in Micronesia, in Maldives. Right? There's so many examples. What about this? Anyone recognize this? I don't know if you dived in around this area. That's the Seven Skies wreck. This whole superstructure has been salvaged. So that's all gone. And these are bigger and more obvious stories of how the environment is changing. The environment that we've been seeing, you know. I've been diving for about 12 years and I've been teaching for about 10. And I've gone back to the same sites over and over again. To a certain extent, if you've been diving long enough time, you'll have seen what I've seen. And you'll have experienced what I've experienced. Loss of things, right? Things that we'll never have again. And this is really what I want to talk about. This concept of shifting baselines. New divers, I mean, I'm an instructor, I get new divers all the time. They go down on their very first dive and they go look at a reef on the right. And they'll go like, wow, I saw some fish, that's so exciting. But we know better, right? We know the reef is really supposed to look like the picture on the left. But they don't know that, right? So this is something that's been concerning me for a long time. I've been thinking about, you know, I've been diving for quite a while and I see these changes, but I can't really quantify it. I can't really, you know, put my finger on it or prove it, but I've seen it happening. I think all of us here have seen it, right? But we can't really quantify it, can't really say for sure. The bigger, more obvious ones like shark loss and all the big sexy awareness programs, everybody knows about that. But what about the reef? And, you know, it's really hard to talk about it. So, for me, that's what kind of got me into conservation, to want to do something about it. On land, it's really easy, right? You get a patch of grass that's been mowed over and eaten out, and it's all dirt. All you need to do is plant some grass and it grows again. Not really the same kind of thing when you talk about reefs. So, for me, what I wanted to do was to be able to give back to the environment that I love so much, to try and build reefs. How that got started was I did some research online and I found out about the BioRock workshop. This was back in 2009, I think. That's me talking to some other coordinators about how to build a reef.
I'm sure you speak louder. There's 10 people watching you now.
Oh, really? Anybody I know? But they cannot hear me, is it?
I can.
Yeah. Okay. So that's me in the BioRock workshop at Gili Trawangan back in 2009. Trying to figure out how to build a reef. I learned a lot then. Dr. Tom Guru, I learned a lot about the biology of reefs, about corals. And, you know, it got me inspired to want to do something back in where I always dive, which is in Tiuman, Salang Beach. So I started this little project under the guise of GUE and Project Baseline. And that's us actually setting out a perimeter of a patch of reef. And we wanted to survey it over time to set sort of a baseline and answer that question I had of being able to prove that the reef is changing over time, for better or for worse, right? Nobody know. We did quite a lot of work here, took a lot of time. This is a little video, an excerpt on the video. Was this was a video showing us laying down perimeter blocks. so that we can mark out the area that we wanted to survey. So it's an interesting project. I'm not a marine biologist. I'm just a dude who likes to go diving. I happened to start teaching as well. And I wanted to do something, but I didn't really know how. And I did a lot of research, talked to a lot of people, but there wasn't a lot of, this was back in 2010, there wasn't a lot of information on how to do it. You know, there's a lot of scientific, there's a science world, like what Dr. Wilkinson was saying just now. There's the science world, and then there's us citizens, and you know, there's not a lot of connection between the two. There's not a lot of ways for people to want to, an avenue for people who have passion to do something about it. And I'm a guy of like action. I want to get things done. I want to go on and do things, and see some change, and see some action. So we did this project and we learned a lot along the way, a lot of trial and error. We actually did a depth plot of the entire site. That's about 30 meters wide and about 100 meters long, so about 3,000 square meters. It was pretty fun. And all of us had a lot of fun. We monitored the water quality, measured the visibility. We did all the regular stuff that the books told us to do, and figured out how to do it along the way. Unfortunately, we stopped going to Tioman so much because of logistical issues, but from time to time, we still go back and look at the site and see how it's changed. So fast forward a few years, I moved to Bali, started another operation there, and one of the things was, after everything was set up and ready to go, operations-wise, I wanted to do something again. Got itchy, you know. I wanted to get, well, let's try to grow a reef again. So me and my partners there, we came up with this idea. My idea here was essentially to take these bits of coral that were already broken, that were broken by a storm or whatever, place it on a structure that is near to an existing reef. So the reef comes up to here and it's barren sand. Why does the reef not grow out further? Probably because there's no substrate. Or when the corals break, they roll around in the sand and they die. So I wanted to give these corals a bit more of a chance. Build a structure that would elevate them into the current flow and get them away from predators. So we devised this little structure, call it a bamboo tripod, made from bamboo and rope and a little paving stone. We wanted to make something, used materials that were easily available, cheap, and you know, sort of disposable. We wanted to build this, set it up, and then over time let the coral overgrow it, so it became part of the natural landscape. That's what we tried to do. This was in first time we did it was in October 2015. These guys were there as well. Remember that? Then, a few months later, we go back and check it out. This was the same tripod we saw before. Now, the problem we faced was, I'm very glad that it's still there after 3 months, but I couldn't tell if it grew or not. It looked like it grew, I hope it grew, but there was no way of knowing. So the challenge of being able to make sure that, like in a scientific way, that it is working has been hard. I think I've been talking to AutoCAD about being able to 3D model these things and at two different times and see if the 3D model grows. But haven't gotten around to that yet. You figure that out, let me know. Okay? So with this, a few months later, we see some success. So we try to do more. So we put on a few more. This was a little bit shallower. As you can see, the existing reef is quite rich. But then there's patches of sand and rubble. So we wanted to, okay, let's see if we can help this reef grow onto this rubble. So we created a few more structures. We even tried a chicken basket. They sell this on the street, right? They put chickens inside. You know, it's got this nice mesh, which is really easy to put corals in. So why not? Let's try it. So we tried it. It was fun, a few months of growth. Around. Now this was before. And the video here actually shows. You can see this coral, this particular coral, is actually this coral up here, right? So it's still there, there's some growth, but you can't really tell from here. Unfortunately, after about almost a year, must have had a big storm, and the bamboo didn't really last, right? Some of them broke apart. Some of them blew off into the current, never to be found again. But it was kind of what we wanted. We didn't want the bamboo to be permanent. You see a lot of structures now out there with the metal structure. And after a while, they rust, nothing grows on them, but they're still kind of there. I wanted something that was biodegradable that would disappear after the coral sort of takes over. Unfortunately, the bamboo didn't last long enough. We learned something from this, that corals don't actually stick to bamboo, sadly. So we thought, okay, so they're not gonna stick on an organic material. So let's try something different. So we tried using bottles. I mean, divers, we drink a lot, right? Secret, but everybody knows it. So we had a lot of bottles and I didn't really want to throw them away because, you know, this was in Bali and they don't really recycle, there's no recycling bins around, we don't know what the program is. So I tended to keep all these bottles and we had them for quite a number of months. And I was thinking, okay, we gotta find a way to use these bottles. And so I thought, hey, that bottle that has that open top is perfect to put a coral in. So that's what we tried to do. So this was our very first casting. Basically, we took some bottles, we cast it into a bed of concrete. And we had a few variations there. We had plastic bottles, we had bottles of different sizes. We had bottles that were a bit more spaced out, bottles that were kind of closer together. So this was December last year. And that's kind of how it looked like after we planted them. What an interesting process. We used ice cream sticks to wedge the coral sprigs into the bottles, and then we put a bit of glue on the sides to hold them, a bit of aquarium glue. It worked kind of well, you know, for a while. Unfortunately, this is what it looked like after about a month. So the corals were still there, they were still growing. Oh, it was still alive. It's only been a month. And this is actually a video, and you'll see the whole thing. In principle, the concept sort of worked. But about a few months later, we put about 10 of these blocks down. Because now that we see that they're still there, they're still growing. Okay, let's put a few more down. Unfortunately, in just before Chinese New Year, end of January, and this video actually shows the blocks moving. In the previous shot, you can see they're all laid out in a nice row. This video here, you can already see the blocks have all shifted. So I'm not sure why this happened, whether it was because of a natural event or human intervention, or whether it was a boat that anchored, and but basically this whole site was destroyed, sadly. So we couldn't really, we haven't had enough time, enough data to tell if it really worked. So you know what, not gonna get deterred. We switched up the dive site and we did it again in March. This time we got a dive operator from Singapore, Dive Race. He runs a live aboard. The owner is a friend of mine, one of my students before. So he brought his crew, all his dive masters and all them, come down to Bali and participate in this. So we put this down in a different site from the original one, just to see if maybe it was natural factors that caused that destruction. We're gonna go back next week, see if these are all still around. But that's kind of the idea. We try something out, plant some corals, we see if we go back after a while and see if it works. What I'm hoping is that if we can find something that works relatively well over a long period of time, we can slowly start to replicate. I've always been inspired by this story of an Indian guy who planted a tree every day. And after 30 years, you know this story, right? After 30 years, he planted an entire forest. That's what I'm inspired by. That's what I want to do. I want to do it for the ocean. You know, it's a hard thing to monitor. We don't go there every day. It's not like you wake up out of your house and then you just walk down the street and you're in the forest. I wish it were. But, you know, we will continue this work, and we'll try to see what else we can do. But, you know, I think this is really important for dive operators. We had a grand opening in a shop in Jakarta, Martin from CTC, which I hope I will introduce to you later. He said this, can you imagine if Mola Molas and Mantas disappear? People will have no reason to visit Nusa Penida. And this struck a chord with us, all of us at Livingseas, because it's so true, right? People tend to focus on the big, beautiful megafauna. But what about the small things? Stories of all the reefs gone in Kobon, but the mantas still come, but for how much longer? That was part of the reason why Dive Race wanted to come and learn this coral technique, because he dives there a lot. He doesn't want to see the reef degrade to the point where the mantas don't come, and then he won't have a business anymore, you know? So to me, I feel that this is something that, you know, ensuring coral reefs for life, this is the base level of all the other stuff that people like to look at, the nudibranchs, the little fish, the fish that we eat. You know, the coral reefs are the ones that form the base of this, the base of the pyramid. Now, I have a few more videos here, which you can't really see, but you can sort of see from there. This is another problem that I noticed being an instructor. And this is something that matters, or is more directly influenced by us as operators. This is an open water class. And you can sort of see what they're doing, right? If the video would play, you'd see the instructor, who is the one back facing us, start to teach his students how to clear, do a mask removal and replacement. Look at the coral. This is in Bali. Look at the ground. It's all sand, coral rubble, and they're doing skills standing up in the water. Thankfully, there are no agency people around. But this is unfortunately something that is directly within our control. I don't see why this is still happening, to be honest. People will come to diving, and this comes back to what I was saying about shifting baselines. To them, these students, they go down, they experience being underwater, and they had so much fun, right? But that reef was not like that before. That coral rubble had to have come from somewhere. Where do you think, how do you think it got that way? It's because of repeated people training and doing that. We have stories from Tioman, from Koh Tao, Koh Samui, Koh Phi Phi, all the places with major open water activity, open water course activity. And nobody wants to go there because the reefs end up looking like this. But why? You know, as operators, I think we have a direct responsibility to that, to doing something about it, or training students better. This was the same guys after they were done and moving off, and you can see how much sand they're picking up. Same here. I have a lot of examples. I mean, we don't need to. Oh, what about this? This is in Komodo, and there's a manta right behind the dive guide on the back, and two of his students on reef hooks, sitting there, literally sitting on the reef, looking at the manta. Why does this need to continue happening? And that's part of my problem. The baseline has shifted so much that this is acceptable behavior. This is the norm now. But how did it get to this stage? That's what I wonder. Is there something we can do about it? I think as operators, our biggest responsibility is to train our students better. This video is actually from one of our open water classes, where the student is doing out of gas sharing, and he's off the bottom totally. This is his third dive. So I believe, and we are doing our best to train students to not touch the bottom. That diving means you be like a fish, not like a human walking around underwater. I think that needs to change from an operator's point of view. Because if I'm operating out of an area, it means I'm going to the same spots over and over again. And if I'm destroying the same spots over and over again, what's going to happen to my business after 10 years, after 15 years? And what are you training people for? You know? And that's really what I wanted to talk about today. If you notice the pictures and the videos of us, we don't touch the bottom at all. And I think that's the way it should be. So I challenge operators in general, instructors, people who have passion, who say they have passion for the environment. Let's not do things the way you were taught. Let's be better for the environment. Let's get off the bottom, let's train people better. It is possible. At the end of the day, you can't be a real diver if you don't appreciate the environment. If not, you're just a tourist. You just come and see what you want to see and then you go off. There's no real, there's no investment into it. So for all the instructors out there who are watching this and who listen to this later on, I challenge you, what kind of divers do you want to build? And that's really the question today. So conservation is at the heart of what we do, right? We as divers, we became instructors, we dive a lot because we love the ocean. But are we passing this on to the next generation? Well, as instructors, that is our responsibility. It's not just about keeping them safe, about, you know, to put it bluntly, so that they don't kill themselves in the water, right? It's not just about that. How are we also developing and building the passion and the appreciation for the environment, we can't do this ourselves. Okay? So that's it. That's it. Thank you. Why is that the norm? Why should it be the norm? That's what I have a problem with. Because we try to do things differently. We make it a point to do things differently.
You know, you want divers to be comfortable in the water, but if you're not spending enough time to teach them how to be comfortable in the water, they're not going to be your customers. They're just going to go off to another sport.
Exactly. If they're not comfortable and they're not actually enjoying themselves, then they're not going to continue diving. I always feel like it's stealing candy from a baby. And the industry has moved to this level where the open water is the loss leader. I'm going to lose money on this, that's fine, because they'll come back for more courses and I'll sell them more equipment. But that's not the point. That's not building the appreciation for the environment.
Yeah.
That's what kind of bugs me. Because we have so many lost opportunities here. New divers coming in who maybe 10-20% of them continue and develop the passion on their own. If we spend a little bit more effort to help them along that path, can we make that number higher, 30, 40, 50% who really love the ocean? And that's when change will really happen. Right? The change from the stakeholders that we were talking about. That's how I believe it will begin to happen. But until that sort of mosquito revolution happens, it's not going to change. If all that standing around is the norm, then
it's not going to change.
It's not going to change.
Yeah.
So that's my message.
That's a very important message. We'll post this on our site.